Sweet Treats candy donations are now open.
The goal is 80,000 pieces of candy. You can donate to the buckets in the lobby or our church office. If your core group is interested in volunteering at Sweets and Treats, contact Children's Ministry Director Julie Duvall at jduvall@fbcbolivar.org.
Men's Prayer Breakfast is back this Saturday from 7 to 8 in the Fellowship Hall. As always, there's a great time to gather together, spend time in God's Word, and eat a hearty breakfast. We hope you can attend.
Senior Adult Luncheon is next Sunday at noon in the Fellowship Hall. Senior adults will be gathering together for a time of fellowship and community over a delicious meal.
Man, we sure do eat a lot here at this church.
Sounds like it. Looking forward.
Good thing I know the lady that does a lot of those foods. Friday night's movies is now Saturday night movies at the Esquire. Every Saturday night in October, there will be a movie showing at the Esquire Theater. This Saturday's movie is A Little Mermaid.
Oh, wow. Awesome.
Doors will open at 5:30 and the movie will begin at 6. Admission and concessions are free. Make sure to invite a friend and bring the whole family for a night of fun.
Recess is this Saturday. If you haven't heard of Recess, this event focuses on a safe and fun kids' night out approach for kids with special needs and their siblings to hang out, let loose, and have fun. Parents can drop off their kids at the rec building at 5 p.m. and pick them up at 8:30. You can register at fbcbolivar.org/recess. Have questions or interested in volunteering? Contact Holly Schuler at recess@fbcbolivar.org.
Man, maybe if they want to have a lot of fun, they can wear an outlet fit like this.
Hey.
We're excited to have you here, Michael, and there's going to be one last opportunity for the First Baptist family to get to know you starting this afternoon. Join us for a question and answer session with Michael at 3 p.m. in the Fellowship Hall. Then there will be a called business meeting on October 8th in all of our morning services.
Is this your first time worshiping with us? We invite you to text the word GUEST to 417-282-8322. You can also visit one of the info hubs after the service where we can meet you and help you get more connected to First Baptist. Let's worship together.
Let's worship.
Awesome.
Welcome to First Baptist. We're so glad you're here today. We want to welcome those who are listening on the radio or watching online as well. Let's begin with a reading from Psalm 24, verses 7 through 10. Lift up your heads, O gates, and be lifted up, O ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in. Who is the King of glory? The Lord strong and mighty, the Lord mighty in battle. Lift up your heads, O gates, and lift them up, O ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in. Who is this King of glory? The Lord of hosts, he is the King of glory. Selah. Let's stand together as we sing The Lion and the Lamb.
Will bow.
Let's continue our worship with hymn 511, The Solid Rock. Amen. You may be seated.
Is my friend Aaliyah, and she has made the decision to walk in obedience and be baptized this morning. And so we get to hear her story, and so her mom is going to read her testimony.
Before I gave my life to Christ, I feel like things were more difficult, and I was always lost. Like I didn't know what to do most of the time. I felt like something was missing to make my life better, but I wasn't sure what that was. So one day, I decided to read my Bible when I was really stressed out, and it really helped. And after, I was a lot less stressed. So the next time I felt that way, I read my Bible and I would pray, and I started thinking about getting saved. About a week later, I went to Falls Creek. It was the second day of camp, and the guy working the rock climbing wall was unhooking me and taking off my harness. While he was doing this, he was asking me questions like if I had been saved and if I wanted to be saved. And the guy working the rock climbing wall then prayed with me and I got saved. After that, I felt happier and I didn't feel lost anymore.
So, hey, is that your story? Yes. Hey, do you believe that Jesus died on the cross and rose again from the grave?
Yes.
Awesome. And have you confessed that Jesus is the boss and the Lord of your life?
Yes.
Awesome. Well then, Aaliyah, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit.
Let's stand and sing together, Living Hope.
Turn to heaven and
spoke your name into the night. And through the darkness, your loving kindness saw through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear
Jesus, you taught us to pray. Our Father, which art in heaven, for heaven is your throne, the earth your footstool. Hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom, which we seek first, let it come. Thy will, which is our food, let it be done on earth as it is in heaven. Lord, as we prepare to give, we ask first that you would give to us our daily bread. We ask that you would forgive us of our debts, as we have forgiven those indebted to us, as in the year of Jubilee. We ask that you would lead us not into temptation, for we are tempted, each of us in our own way, to put money and our own selves above you, to put our trust in those things rather than putting our trust in Christ. Lord, deliver us from evil. And now as we give, let our offering be one of gratitude and of love, not as though you needed anything, for you need nothing, O God, from us, but we give because you have so lavishly given to us through Christ. And we pray that as we give, that others might know that thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you. Michael Green, our candidate for the college ministry, on behalf of the search committee. He is a great, great man that really connects with a lot of individuals, and we're very excited to have him. This afternoon at 3 o'clock, there will be a question and answer session for anybody to attend to meet with him one-on-one and ask any questions that you have of him. That will be in the fellowship hall. Next Sunday, there will be a called business meeting in all three services where we will vote on Michael. If you cannot attend next Sunday, there will be absentee ballots in the church office starting tomorrow. So looking forward to hearing to what Michael has to say.
Well, I just want to begin by extending my thanks to the search committee. I've gotten to know them over the last few months, and especially this week, their families, them, the church staff. Everyone that I've met at the church really has been very hospitable, very kind to me. I've gotten to experience Midwestern hospitality through many meals this week, so I'm very thankful for that. I'm going to have to fast next week to make up for all that I've eaten. So I have been praying for this day eagerly and expectantly for some time now. I've been praying for you, First Baptist, for a long time. I count it a privilege to even be nominated as your college minister candidate, and I'm thankful to be here with you today. My name is Michael Green. I'm originally from Phoenix, Arizona. I was blessed to be raised in a Christian home. Four generations of pastors in my home. And so I heard a lot about the Lord growing up. It was woven into the fabric of my upbringing. From an early age, I got to hear stories about Jesus. I got to see the transformation that happened in someone's life when they gave their life to Jesus. And then, like you've heard this story countless times, I'm sure, I attended Vacation Bible School one year at 9 years old. And I heard the stories that I had heard since childhood, but they unfolded to me in a very new way. The Lord began to expose to me some things that I hadn't known yet, like that sin is not just doing something wrong, but rather sin is an offense to God, and God demands justice. And because God demands justice, I knew that I had sinned, and therefore I needed salvation from that sin, and I knew that there was only one who could provide that, the Lord Jesus Christ. So that evening, I went home and I told my dad, I want to know Jesus today. And so I prayed and I gave my life to Jesus as my Savior and Lord. And he changed my life forever. However, journeying through middle school and especially high school, I faced a lot of struggles. I began to question whether my faith was truly my faith or was it just a product of my upbringing. And so these doubts were exacerbated by the typical struggles that teens face and identity issues. But it was during high school that I encountered some very serious and real health issues, and I began to ask even more questions. Why me? My friends are okay. They're continuing on with high school fine. They seem to be going through things seamlessly, but I did something that I hadn't done before. I opened up God's Word for the first time on my own. And the Holy Spirit began to minister to me through His Word. I learned for the first time to lean on Him for strength, for comfort, for grace through His Word. I began to find answers to questions that I had for years. And that really began to cause my faith to be that much more personal to me. And it was in that the Lord began to work even more. And He gave me a calling on my life. I saw what He had done through the Word in my heart. And I wanted to see that done even more so. So I felt an undeniable call from the Lord to vocational ministry, to devote myself to the ministry of the Word, to devote myself to teaching, preaching, discipleship, so that I could see that done in God's kingdom even more. And so I stand before you today as these paths that we've all been on today intersect, so to speak. And if the Lord has it in His plan for me to be the next college minister at First Baptist Bolivar, I'd like to share with you just a little bit of what I could say a vision for the college ministry, a vision of what I would seek to accomplish, and what better place to turn for a vision for the church than his word. So I'm going to read from 2 Timothy chapter 4. This is what I would seek to accomplish as a college minister here at First Baptist Bolivar. I charge you in the presence of God and of Christ Jesus, who is to judge the living and the dead, by his appearing in his kingdom, preach the word. Be ready in season and out of season. Reprove, rebuke, and exhort with complete patience and teaching. For the time is coming when people will not endure sound doctrine, but having itching ears, they will accumulate for themselves teachers to suit their various passions, and will turn away from listening to the truth and will wander off into myths. As for you, always be sober-minded, endure suffering, do the work of an evangelist, fulfill your ministry. Thank you.
In just a moment, before we transition out of this part of the service and into the sermon, I would like for us to pray. I could say for Michael, certainly for Michael, we want to do that, but really just praying for our entire church and what God has for all of us and his ministry to college students in our community. So we want to do that, and as I do, just remember what Dustin said. We will have a Q&A time for you to ask questions of Michael this afternoon at 3 in the fellowship hall, and then next week in all three morning services, we'll have the opportunity to vote on Michael. So let's pray together as we transition today. So gracious Father, we do thank you so much, first and foremost, just for your Son, our Savior and Lord Jesus Christ. Lord, thank you so much that in and through him, Lord, we have peace, we have hope, we have forgiveness, and we have right relationship with you. And Lord, as we think about that, really, as your people and as your church, first and foremost, we just want to be your representatives, your reflections in this world, and specifically for First Baptist, the community that you've placed us in, the Bolivar community. Father, as I think about that, I'm just so thankful for your past faithfulness to and through our church. Lord, you have shown and proved yourself worthy and faithful. And Lord, you've given us opportunity after opportunity to be your hands and feet and to proclaim the gospel here in the community that you've called us to and that you've put us in. And Lord, we are trusting you that you have future plans to continue to do the same thing, and we just want to be obedient to you. Lord, with that in mind, we thank you for Michael. We thank you for who he is. Thank you for bringing him all this way and bringing him to this moment. And for him, Lord, I know he does, but I just pray for peace for him and whatever your plan is for the next steps. If it's here, Lord, we will rejoice. And Lord, we will just seek you through it all. And I pray that you would give him safe travels back home as he leaves today and goes back. And Lord, for our church, I pray for your direction for us, that you would just give us a clear understanding of what your will is. And more than any personal desires or thoughts, help us to be submissive to you and do it in such a way to where you get the glory and that your will is done. Just together and collectively, more than anything, we desire to be obedient to you, to go out and serve you, and to be a church that would proclaim the gospel and see people come to faith in Christ and have their lives changed. So, Lord, we just submit this to you, trusting you with it and entrusting it to you. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thanks, man. Thanks. All right, if you would take your Bibles and join me in the short New Testament epistle of Jude. If you're looking for it, go all the way to the right in your Bible. You will be in the book of Revelation and back up one book. And it's a short book, only 25 verses. And often, perhaps, in the teaching and preaching of the church, it's overlooked. But I think it is a significant book for the church, especially as it relates to application for the culture and the world we find ourselves in today. And so, as already has been mentioned, we will be starting a new sermon series beginning today that will take us through October and into the first Sunday in November from this little book. From my perspective, I actually think it makes sense and is an intentional companion to what we looked at this summer in the book of Proverbs. If you remember there, we focused on God's wisdom applied to the individual believer so that we could live and navigate this life in a successful way. Well, in some ways, the book of Jude is side B to that conversation. For in it, I believe we see that which comes only from God, His strength and His presence that helps not the individual, but the church navigate the world and culture in which we find ourselves in such a way to where we act as the church that He's called us to be. So with that in mind, you've already seen the title, but what we want to call the entire series is A Steady Church in a Shaky World. And prayerfully, if I do my job today and in the weeks to come, you will understand why. As we think about this book, just a little bit of context of the whole. Verse 1 identifies as the author, as the writer, a guy by the name of Jude. He describes himself in the first part of verse 1 in a way that does something that's often hard for human beings to accomplish. He simultaneously balances the authority he has with a genuine humility. You might ask, how in the world does he do that? Well, he first identifies himself as a servant of Jesus Christ. Surely one of the favorite titles of the followers of Christ in the New Testament. But then he follows that up by referring to himself as a brother of James. Makes the most sense to us that this would be the most well-known James in the New Testament, which clearly would be the James who wrote the Epistle of James, was the leader of the church in Jerusalem in the early days, and therefore himself was a half-brother of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. What makes that so significant is that Jude, therefore, has a direct link to the early teaching of the apostle doctrine in the church, authority. And oh, by the way, that also means that Jude himself is a half-brother of Jesus. Yet he doesn't appeal to that authority at all. Instead, he only wants to connect himself to Jesus as a servant. There's the humility. Authority to speak, humility to be a servant. We believe it's possible that Jude perhaps wrote this epistle between the years of 70 and 80 AD to Palestinian Jews who had converted to Christianity. And as such, certainly, it was those that both from without and from within knew what it meant to live in a hard culture. You will quickly see that a major point that he makes is false teachers, ungodly people have already infiltrated the church, but don't worry, their end of destruction is already clear. Yet that is not Jude's call to action. That might be a point he makes, but that's not his call to action. Instead, he bases his call to action on a certainty. Even though that's the case, we have everything we need in and from God to sustain against it. Therefore, the call to action throughout the whole thing is do not be afraid to be the church, in the church for the sake of the church, but also for the world. With that in mind, just listen to the first four verses that we want to look at together today. Here's what the Word of God says. Jude, a servant of Jesus Christ and brother of James, to those who are called, beloved in God the Father, and kept for Jesus Christ, may mercy, peace, and love be multiplied to you. Beloved, although I was very eager to write to you about our common salvation, I found it necessary to write appealing to you to contend for the faith that was once for all delivered to the saints. For certain people have crept in unnoticed, who long ago were designated for this condemnation, ungodly people who pervert the grace of our God into sensuality and deny our only Master and Lord, Jesus Christ. Several years ago, I read a story about a young girl who had never been to the beach before. She had never been to or seen the ocean. And so one summer, her mom and dad thought they needed to solve that problem, and so they loaded up, and for family vacation, mom, dad, and little girl went to the beach. Now, at the beach, having never seen the ocean or been able to play in sand in that natural habitat, she had one goal for the week. She wanted to build the most elaborate sandcastle she could possibly produce. And so day one hit, and they, in the morning, rushed down to the beach, and her chore commenced. She had her bucket, she had all of her tools, and she began to work meticulously to construct this sandcastle. And for a young age, she did a pretty good job. In her mind, at least, it was a nice, sturdy sandcastle. And so she finished, they looked at it, took pride in it, and they left for the day. The only problem was there was also a little boy of about the same age that was there vacationing with his parents at the same time. And he came by the sandcastle and he noticed it. And the thought that went through his mind is to destroy it, to stomp it out with both feet. And this he did. So the girl came to the beach the next day hoping to find her castle, but it was gone. She was undeterred. She went through the same process the second day, and she built an even better, in her mind, more elaborate castle that next day. And she once again left pretty satisfied with herself. Long came the same boy and repeated the same action again. So the third day, the events of that day went much like the events of the first 2 days. She built it, proud of herself, left. The boy came, and he destroyed it once more. Now, we might find ourselves asking the question, why in the world did that little boy do that? Oh, friend, this morning we do not have the time, nor do I have the energy or the expertise to get into the psychology of what would cause a little boy to do that. My wife would stand up and give testimony and say, I live with two boys, one little and one a little bigger, and I have no idea why either of them do the things they do in my house. But certainly one of the reasons why the little boy did it could be boiled down to this. Because the castle wasn't his. You see, we have a tendency as people, whether we act on it or not, to tend to want to tear up things that don't belong to us, to tear up kingdoms that are not ours. I read not long ago a well-known Christian leader who said, the world tends to get mad or angry at Christians not when they do act like Christians, but when they do not. To which my response would be, I think there's some merit to that. I think there's some truth to that. I know the point that he's making. However, my response to you would be, Jesus said if the world hates us, remember it hated him first. And I am convinced this morning that the reason the world hated Jesus was not because, or was not because he did not act like a Christian. It's not why the world hated Jesus. As a matter of fact, I would tell you the reason the world hated Jesus is because he did act Christ-like. And also because the kingdom that he builds is not of this world. Therefore, the world has a tendency to want to destroy it, to discredit it, and redefine it. And that's what we see over and over again. And the church is certainly a reflection, if not a representation, of Jesus' kingdom in this world. Therefore, we should not be surprised when the world, of which this kingdom does not belong, wants to destroy us in the work of Christ. With that in mind, we might be tempted to ask this question. if that's the case, Adam, why in the world would I ever want to be a part of something that is just always under so much attack and in so much turmoil and that the world wants to destroy? And our follow-up question might be, and if I do want to be a part of it, is there any hope to withstand at all this that might come? And beyond that, what would the act and the work of withstanding even look like? Well, the great news is I believe Jude, in these short 25 verses, goes a long way to begin to address these questions. And in our introductory message that I want us to look at today, we already begin to see hints towards the answers. So I want us to look today at this passage, considering two truths as quickly as we can, with this thought in mind. How can the church withstand, and what does it look like for us to do so? First of all, the first truth that I want you to see is again in verses 1 and 2, and it's what I've called the sure identity of the church. The sure identity of the church. Here again, verses 1 and 2. Jude, a servant of Jesus Christ and brother of James, to those who are called, beloved in God the Father, and kept for Jesus Christ, may mercy, peace, and love be multiplied to you. After Jude introduces himself, a part of the text that we will not go back to since we already talked about it in the introduction, he then talks to and about those that he's writing this epistle to. It may or may not surprise you that Jude does not do something in his epistle that many of the other New Testament letters do. Jude, in his epistle, never once uses the New Testament term that is often translated as church. Never calls who he's talking to the church or a church. And so you might say, well, then how can you even give this series the title, A Steady Church in a Shaky World? Well, when we look at how he describes who he's writing to, there can seem to be no doubt, even if he's not talking to a specific local congregation, he is certainly talking to the church, generally speaking, because of the way he describes them. Who else could be those that he describes this way? So with that in mind, there's two characteristics that we see of the identity of the church that I just want you to consider here for a moment. First of all, for this first characteristic of the identity of the church, look at what we see in the second part of verse 1. The church is those who have been redeemed by Christ. Just listen to how he describes those that he's writing to. To those who are called, beloved in God the Father, and kept for Jesus Christ. I mean, just for a moment, in the world in which we live, who else could he be talking about? To say it another way, if anybody meets these descriptors, it must be the church that has been redeemed and has confessed faith in Jesus. It could be no one else. We look at these terms, interesting enough, these descriptors, called, beloved, and kept, are all used in some form in the Hebrew language of the children of Israel within the book of Isaiah. In the prophetic book Isaiah, all three of these terms are used to describe the Old Testament covenant people of God. Clearly, they are those that had a special, unique relationship with God in the Old Testament. They are those that God had called as his children out of bondage in Egypt and redeemed. They are those that he loved and stayed in relationship with even when they rejected him. And at least the remnant, it is those that he kept even when they went through exile and punishment for their sin, regardless of the hardship that came. Jude, being a good Jewish man, understanding these, now takes these same concepts and applies them to not Israel, but the church. Now, I don't know where you are in your understanding of the relationship between Israel and the church. And I'm certainly not necessarily saying that the church in every way is the new Israel in some type of complete replacement theology. But what I am telling you is, just like Israel in the Old Testament had a unique relationship with God, now the church, from the time of Christ and beyond, has a unique relationship with God. We are those that have been called out of our sin. We are those who are beloved by and in God. And certainly, come what may, regardless of the difficulties, and even in the midst of attack, we are the ones that can know we are kept by and for Jesus and the day of His return. Things that I find fascinating is usually when these descriptors are looked at, the one that's pulled out and focused on for a good fight or debate, you guessed it, is the first one called. And so people begin to debate over this. Is this some type of effectual call, or is this talking about election? Listen, we can have that argument offline if you want to, but I think it's an unnecessary one for the point that Jude is making here. What do I mean by that? Well, there's at least two parts of the doctrine that he's trying to say here about our salvation, our redemption in Christ, that I hope we don't need to argue over at all. Well, what is it? Well, first and foremost, the point that he's making with these terms is, guess who saved you? You didn't save yourself. God saved you. And the second part of that follows closely. The point is, if God is the one that saved you and you are in Christ, then guess who is capable of keeping you? Even when the attacks come, that same God that saved you. Since our salvation is not contingent upon how good we can be on our own, neither is our ability to withstand in the world in which we find ourselves. The church, characteristically, is those who have been redeemed by Christ. But he doesn't stop there with his description of our identity as the church. Look at verse 2. This is the one we forget. Often we think as the church, that initial salvation was great, Jesus saved me, and I don't need him anymore in my life. But that's not true. You see, there's two parts to this. The church is those who have been redeemed by Christ, but the church is also those who are still in need of Christ every day. We see this in verse 2. May mercy, peace, and love be multiplied to you. Now, what is fascinating is you look at that and you go, mercy, peace, and love. If there's anybody in the world who has this, it would seem to be those who have been redeemed by Christ. So why is Jude saying, I want you to have these things that supposedly you already have? Many of you don't know this story about my son, but he was born 3 weeks early. And you would never know now by looking at him, but he was teensy tiny when he was born. And the delivery, for the most part, went pretty well. He was put on Holly's chest, and she got to see him for a moment. Then they moved into the side of the room and began to work on him. And I quickly realized something wasn't right. They hit a button, made a call, and few nurses from the NICU came up and began to work on him as well. And Holly looked at me, her eyes got about that big, and she said, what's wrong? Mother's intuition, she knew it. And I couldn't quite tell, but something wasn't going on. Well, very quickly, they actually took him out of the room, and they took him down, and he was in NICU. Not as bad as some other people. I know people have had it much worse, but he spent the first 6 days of his life in the NICU. And they never had to intubate him, but what they did have to do is give him oxygen for some time so that he could actually transition into the world. Now, Holly and I already had two other kids at the time, but we learned something about babies that we, believe it or not, never knew before. And here's what we learned. Maybe you already knew this. Maybe you're smarter than me. You see, when babies are born, in order for them to live, they don't just need one initial breath. You see, he took an initial breath. But believe it or not, to keep living, they need to keep breathing. Did you know that? See, Alex's problem wasn't the initial breath. He took one fine, but then he struggled to continue to breathe after that. Well, obviously, I'm being tongue-in-cheek. I know that babies need to continue to breathe every minute, every second, if they're going to be viable after birth. What does that have to do with us? So many times as a church, we don't understand if we're to continue to live, not only do we need Jesus for initial salvation, but we need Him and what He provides in our life every day, every hour, every minute, and every second after that. And that's what Jude is reminding us of here. We don't just need the initial love of God, but we are those that need to continue to have mercy, peace, and love multiplied, filled up in us, which is really what the word means. We need it to its fullest extent. And it's especially the case for the church when we find ourselves facing false teachers or those that would try to destroy us. We need God's mercy to hold on to what we have found in Christ. We need His peace when the turmoil comes in the world and it hits us right where we are. And certainly we need His love so that we see the people of this world and maybe even those that are attacking us, not through our eyes of fallen sinfulness, but through the eyes of God that still has tremendous love for them. That's the only way we can continue to be the church. Yes, we understand our identity is sure. And as the church, the sure identity is we are those who are redeemed by Christ but are still in need of Him. That's what we have to withstand. But what does our withstanding look like? Well, to answer this, we must look at verses 3 and 4. You see, we don't just see the sure identity of the church, but in verses 3 and 4, we see the serious activity from the church. Here again, verses 3 and 4, "Beloved, although I was very eager to write to you about our common salvation, I found it necessary to write appealing to you to contend for the faith that was once for all delivered to the saints. For certain people have crept in unnoticed who long ago were designated for this condemnation. Ungodly people who pervert the grace of our God into sensuality and deny our only Master and Lord, Jesus Christ." I love the fact that even in the introductory verses, Jude not only tells us who we are as the church, but he tells us what we must do as the church. I think we can say it another way. Jude tends to tell us here, I think, what we must do as the church because of who we are as the church. They're intimately linked. And in this particular case, he does so by way of a contrast in verse 3. I love this. Perhaps no other New Testament writer lets us in to what was going on behind the scenes of the writing of the letter the way that Jude does. You see, in the first part of verse 3, he tells us the letter that he wanted to write. In the second part of verse 3, he tells us the letter that he had to write, which is the letter we have. So just for a moment, hear his description of what he wanted to write to this group of people. "Beloved, although I was very eager to write to you about our common salvation." In other words, what he set out to do, what he wanted to do, was write to them about their common salvation. It's Jude's way of again saying, "I believe you know the Lord. I believe you were saved the same way that I am, and I wanted to encourage you in that. I wanted to give you an attaboy. I wanted to show you this picture, an encouraging picture, to just labor on and to continue to see the goodness of Christ, to worship Christ, to exalt Christ." That's what he seems to be saying. That's the letter he wanted to write, a letter of encouragement. By the way, I hope one day I don't stand before God and have to answer for this because I should not have said it, but there's a sense in which I wish we did have a copy of that letter that he wanted to write. Don't you? Wouldn't you love to see that letter? I'd love to see just that encouragement of our common salvation. But Jude contrasts that and says, but friends, loved ones, that's not the letter I had to write. Letter I wanted to write, but the letter you actually hold in your hand is a different letter. Because here's the letter I had to write. "I found it necessary to write appealing to you to contend for the faith that was once for all delivered to the saints." Here's the activity the church must do. This is the letter we hold in our hands. What we see in the rest of this letter is what it looks like for the church to contend for the faith that was once for all delivered to the saints. The word contend, the word translated contend here, in its form here, is only used one time in the entire New Testament right here. Yet its derivative or root words that are closely associated with it are used other times. And the word carries with it this idea that reflects the striving of an athlete. Think about something that's ongoing and can even be agonizing. I know in several of our services, maybe even in this one, we have junior high athletes, we have high school athletes, maybe even some college athletes here. I know we do in our church. And that might give a good picture of what does it look like, the hard work, the ongoing work that goes into being successful as an athlete. But some have said we can even be more specific. The word that he's using actually carries with it a very specific athletic event. It's the struggling in close quarters that happens between two wrestlers. That's what he's meaning here. To wrestle, if you will, well for the faith that was once for all delivered to the saints. Just for a moment here. When we hear the word faith, most of the time in the Bible, we think of our personal conversion. My experience with Jesus. What God did in my life and my ongoing relationship with Him. It's not that that's unimportant, and it's not that that's not reality, but that is not what Jude means here by the faith, once for all, delivered or handed down to the saints. You see, if there's not historical, factual reality behind our experience with Jesus, then our faith, as Paul wrote in 1 Corinthians 15, is really empty. It's an empty faith. So here he's not talking about contend for your own faith. He's talking about contend for a body of belief that is historically and factually verifiable, that was handed down from eyewitnesses. Essentially what we hold in the New Testament, what we hold in the gospel. Don't give ground on those things. Contend, wrestle, strive, agonize, struggle for those things. Don't let go of the rope. We must be those as the church that do that. You might say, well, what are some of these things? Not just my faith, not my experience with the Lord, but things that we would say is the historical, orthodox foundation of Christianity, that Jesus Christ, God in the flesh, was born of a virgin, that he lived a perfect, obedient life, perfectly obeying the Father without sin, that he went to the cross literally and historically and died for your sins and mine, literally the sins of the entire world, and that he died, and it was a real death, and he was put in the tomb for 3 days, and on the third day God miraculously and powerfully raised him from the dead, defeating sin and death once and for all for us, so that we might live and have relationship with the Father. There may be other things, but that's the faith once for all handed down to the saints that we can't give an inch on. And he's saying that is the activity of the church. Now, in verse 4, and we're almost out of time here, he gives a reason why, at the very beginning here, as to why for the church this is necessary. And what he says there in that culture is certainly true in our culture. Here's how he describes it. Here's the reason why. Because, or for the reason of, certain people have crept in unnoticed who long ago were designated for this condemnation. Now listen to me for just a moment. It's almost as if he is saying to them, you've let down your guard. You haven't been as vigilant as you should have been up to this point. And don't let that continue. You must be vigilant now. Let me say a word about this for a moment, about our vigilance and what he's saying about, if I can call it this, the opponents of the faith. Do you notice here what he told them their contending looks like? Did you notice for a moment that he didn't say contend or wrestle against people? Now, to be sure, there are times, right, when our contending for the faith means that we're going to be in conflict with people or the world. There's no question about that. But that's not how Jude describes it. That's not his emphasis here. Even though he's describing the people that have crept in unnoticed, what he calls them to is actually not something negative, but it's something positive, to contend for the faith. Can I confess something to you? I've asked that in all three services now. By the way, it doesn't matter what you say. I have the microphone and mine's on and you don't have one. I'm going to tell you. It's a rhetorical question. But I'm going to confess something to you. I am really good at, even if I don't act on it, in my heart, going after other people. I'm really good at that. people I don't agree with, people maybe that I just have a small nuanced difference in, maybe people that are not Christians at all, maybe people that have said stuff, maybe people that do things that I think are completely wrong. In my heart of hearts, it is easy for me to go after, to contend against them. By the way, if you say, whoa, Pastor, let's be honest. That's human nature. The world is good at that. If you don't believe me, just look on social media. Better yet, don't. Because what you'll find out is the church and Christianity is the exact same way. There might be times that we have to contend against people. I get it. But that is not Jude's emphasis. His call in our vigilance is to contend for the faith. Let's be busy about that. Now listen to how he describes these people, because he does go on to describe them. He says they're ungodly people, they pervert the grace of God into sensuality, and they deny our only master and Lord, Jesus Christ. Now there's a lot of things we could say about them, but the overall description is, it seems to be this. Whatever we know of God and whatever God's really like, if you want to understand who these people are, think of the exact opposite of that. They are against God. They are ungodly. They are the opposite of who God is. And there's a lot that we could say, but the idea seems to be by the way they live and what they say, they are denying that faith that we're to contend for. And ultimately, in denying that faith, who they deny is Christ, his authority and his lordship in our lives and in the world. Now, as we walk through this letter, we will see some more descriptions of these that have contended against the faith. But I think suffice today would just be make three quick observations. Number one, notice that the issue here as an attack on the gospel is not legalism, but it's licentiousness. What do I mean by that? Go to the book of Galatians. The problem in the book of Galatians is they were adding to the gospel. You need the law plus the gospel to be saved. That is not what these guys are doing. That happened in the world, but that's not what's happening here. What they're doing is they're saying, once you're saved, you've got the license to live any way you want. There's no standard of holiness. Go out and live outside the natural bounds that God has created. We're not talking about perfection, but we are saying that once we're saved, it's not what saves us, but once we're saved, we are called to live in such a way that honors Christ, and these guys did not do that. Secondly, notice for a moment that what he seems to be indicated is those who God has the harshest words or judgment for is not the general sheep, but specifically it's those who do harm to the sheep by pretending to be spiritual leaders. There's a saying that one scholar made about the description of these guys, and he said, there has always and always will be those that find their way into the sheepfold without going through the door but climb in another way. And those are always a menace to the true sheep. Now, I would add something to that, and it makes it all the more worse when they get into the sheep pen, they spend all their time trying to drag the true sheep away from the good shepherd. Finally, here's the good news. What this indicates, all that being the case, God is not caught off guard by them. God is not unprepared. He knows exactly what to do, and he knows exactly how to sustain us, the church. Not only just our identity, but our activity, regardless of what's going on and who's doing what. So listen, the church is not just those who are redeemed and still in need of Christ, but the church are those that in our activity who are called to add contending for the faith to our confession of the faith. With that in mind, just ever so quickly, here's the bottom line. Here's the spiritual principle that I want you to leave with today. You can write it, you can underline it, you can look at it, you can star it. It's right there in your worship guide, and it'll be on the screen. Here's the point. Because of who we are as the church, we must be alert to contend well, rightly, for the faith. And by that, we mean the consistent, and I might even add, objective truth of Christianity. That's the payoff. And that's what we're called to in the book of Jude. The fourth day for the little girl, in some ways, looked a lot like the previous three. She thought she would try one more time. She went to the beach with her family. She built a nice sandcastle. She looked at it, took some pictures, and in pride left for the afternoon. Little boy, after leaving, came along, saw the sandcastle one more time, and this time he was even more eager to destroy the girl's sandcastle. So he reared back with his foot, lifted it as high as was possible, and with all the force that he had in his little body, he smashed down on that castle. The difference this time is that it didn't crumble. Instead, through his foot, up through his leg, and shaking his whole body, he felt the most intense pain that he'd ever felt to that point in his young life. You see, before the young lady, this time, built the castle, she laid a foundation of bricks under each part of that castle. And the sand was just the covering for the foundation that was underneath it. The church is a reflection of Jesus' kingdom, a kingdom that he has built to withstand the attacks of the world. Because he has built it on bricks. Or better yet, he's built it on the rock. And so attacks that come from without or from within will not destroy the church. He promised it. But perhaps what is most significant to the world, who often is trying to attack that kingdom that does not belong to them, is the standing of the church and Jesus' kingdom is actually for their good, unbeknownst to them. You see, because it's through the church and the work of the church that Jesus has chosen to proclaim his goodness, his grace, his mercy, his love, and bring about transformation. Just listen to what he himself said in Matthew chapter 16, verses 13 through 19. Now, when Jesus came into the district of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, "Who do people say that the Son of Man is?" They said, "Some say John the Baptist, others Elijah, and others Jeremiah, or one of the prophets." And he said to them, "But who do you say that I am?" And Simon Peter replied, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." And Jesus answered him, "Blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. And I tell you, you are Peter, and on this rock, the confession of the Christ, I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. And I will give you the keys to the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven." Friend, brother, and sister, even in the midst of a shaky world, you go out with the confidence to be the church that's built on the rock, to proclaim his gospel, to worship Christ, and to build his kingdom. Would you pray with me this morning? Father, I just come before you this morning, and as always, we thank you for this time together we've had as your church. Lord, we are in awe of your goodness to us. We are blown away of how gracious you are and how kind you are, even through your word, giving us the words of life, showing us the gospel, but then reminding us of its power and need in our life. And Lord, we've seen that today. And we do know we live in shaky times, but Father, you are steady, and because of that, your church can and should have the confidence to be steady. Father, I just pray today that if there's someone here that doesn't know you, that today would be the day of salvation for them. I pray for those in the room maybe that do know you. Maybe there's somebody here today that just needs the confidence to go out in the world and live as the church. You give it to them today. And then, Father, maybe us as a church as a whole, we need to come together to say, how do we get more serious about going out into this world and not contending against people, but contending for the faith. You have your way in this invitation, and whatever we do, whatever you do, we'll give the praise, honor, and glory, for this is your time. And once again, we thank you for Jesus, our Lord and Savior. And it's in his name that we pray and give you these things. Amen and amen.
Together as we sing.
What gift of grace is Jesus my Redeemer? There is no more for heaven now to give. He is my joy, my righteousness and freedom, my steadfast love, my deep and boundless peace. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus.
My sin has been defeated.
Amen. Busy morning this morning. I know we're ready to go. I'm going to ask if everyone be seated for just a moment. We have one announcement, and then we're going to have our benediction. But before we do, I've got exciting news to share with you. I'm going to ask if the Dvorak's, did I get that right? To come and stand with me. Being from Arkansas, I just knew I wouldn't get it right. So a small miracle happened this morning. This is Dan and Marilyn, and they have been our guests in worship a couple times. I've had a chance to meet them, but they've come forward today to express their interest in becoming an official part of our church by membership. And so they'll be coming by statement, so we'll follow up with them and meet with them sometime in the next few weeks. But I just wanted to have the opportunity to present them to the church and for you just to affirm this movement of God's Spirit by giving a hearty amen. Amen. And you'll want to, as you see them in service and as you see them in the hallway, to introduce yourself and welcome them. God bless you guys. We're so glad that you're here. I'll let you have a seat. And I think we have a video, and then Mason will come and dismiss us with our benediction.
Hi, my name's Jim Jones. I'm a member of the What's Next Committee, and it's my opportunity to share with you the first of our goals in the strategic plan that we're setting forth for First Baptist Church. As we get started, let me just remind you of a couple of things. One, these goals and objectives are areas where we are putting new emphasis and new energies. There's lots of ministries we're doing that are just really great and effective, and we're going to continue those. But this is where we're going to spend new time, new energy. And second, the What's Next Committee just didn't come up with these objectives and goals on our own. We had listening sessions and focus groups, and it was really the Holy Spirit working through the members of our community that brought those items that are most important to us to the surface, and we just compiled those and put those together in these goals and objectives. So, with that in mind, let's go ahead and get to the goals. Goal number one, local ministry focus. FBC will demonstrate that we care about people, the good of our community, and the gospel by serving and increasing our engagement in local ministries. In 2024, we hope to create an internal database with community ministries, resources, and current needs in order to engage in local ministries, along with administrative structure to ensure that these are effectively communicated. In addition, we're going to explore opportunities to serve the local community and engage in local ministries as an individual or as a core group. We're also going to create a culture of service in which each core group, in which the members serve the community together or engage in local ministries from a heart of compassion and for the glory of God. We also want to prayer walk various areas of Polk County as the core groups or as ministry teams, and highlight local ministry engagement and share these stories of how God is actually working through us for the good of others, for the good of Polk County, and for the spread of the gospel. In the next couple of years past, 2025 and 2026, we really want to bring a new ministry or a new partnership addressing an area of people group that is seemingly overlooked in Southwest Missouri. We'd also hope to achieve 80% of our adult core groups participating in local mission, outreach, or service projects each semester. This is the first goal and objective that we have, and we look forward to discussing with this further. If you have any questions, reach out to any of the What's Next Committee members. Thank you very much for your time.
Good morning, church. My name is Mason Bolin, and I have the opportunity to serve as the missions intern here at FBC. And I come to you today because last week we were able to share about Levi Lentz and the work that he's doing in Papua New Guinea. He has worked very hard since 2009 to translate with his team there the entire New Testament and a lot of the key portions of the Old Testament. And they have completed their work. And now they are going to be printing the Bible in the North Wagi language. And so we're really excited today to just present that to you guys and have the opportunity as you walk out today to give offering for the printing of the North Wagi Bible. And there will be people at the exits today just receiving that offering for the printing. But if you guys are new today or you want to connect with the ministry staff, you can text the word connect to the number on the screen. And then also, if you guys would like to meet with Adam and have a conversation with him, either about membership or counseling or anything like that, you can go over to the hospitality room right after service and connect with him. But as we finish today, I'd like you guys to stand as we pray together. Dear Heavenly Father, I just thank you for the opportunity that we get as a church to be on mission, Lord. I just thank you for people in our church that have been sent overseas and are just working diligently to spread the gospel to your people, Lord. I thank you, and I ask that we as a people are generous in our giving to help the work that you have devoted around the world. And I just pray that we can go in peace today and just glorify you in all we do. I thank you, and I pray this in your name. Amen.